Roger Boyce, you are a Times correspondent living in Berlin, and you have written what I think is easily the best book about the Icelandic financial crisis, Meltdown Iceland. But you have been reporting on Iceland for a long time. You came there first in the Cold War, I think.
I covered as a very young cub reporter for Reuters. My first job was the Cold War. Because I have some Danish, and I think in the English imagination, this was enough to understand the Icelandic psyche. I don't think they quite understood the relationship of Denmark to Iceland. But anyway, yes, and it was a very interesting time. And I must say, at that moment, you probably didn't get this in Iceland at the time. At one level, of course, there was a very patriotic, jingoistic coverage in the British papers about the Icelanders stealing our fish and these kind of things. But actually, the ordinary people, especially boys, boys and young men who'd grown up reading stories of heroism at sea, because this is how you're brought up, hornblower and all these other brave and maritime heroes. The Icelanders seemed to us to be really heroic, because it was in the 70s, obviously, it was in the 70s. So it was just after, and we're really of the kind of 1968, post-1968 generation. And we were fed up of Britain's imperial, post-imperial posturing and its sort of thing. And it just looked, and the more the war went on, the more we looked ridiculous. And so there was a whole generation of people, my age, our age maybe.
So you came to...
who were, basically in sympathy with Iceland, because we thought, my God, it's a kind of antithesis to Britain. Britain swaggering, imperial, engaging on aggressive acts without any sensible logic at all. And the brave Icelanders outwitting with these little, pitifully small Coast Guard boats, the might of the Imperial Navy or whatever we call it. That's how we saw it anyway. And it was quite an astonishing time. It was my first story. So I'm very emotionally connected to it. Yeah.
But so why did you decide to write this book?
Well, I was sent by the Times, obviously, in October 2008. In fact, the whole world was sent to Iceland in October 2008. You probably know that. And we all gathered together in Idno and tried to make sense of all this. People I'd known in different wars, in Bosnia and Kosovo and revolutions. And they were all gathered there because Iceland had suddenly been defined as being a country on the brink of collapse, just like Bosnia had been on the brink of collapse, or the Kosovo, or whatever, all these other different places that we'd covered. So there were a lot of people who were extremely ignorant about Iceland, but who knew a lot about why states collapse. And that's why they were flown there, and they sat there in this theatre, this great historic theatre, watching the government struggle. It was really struggling. But of course, most people didn't really understand what was going on, and I'm not even sure that the government really understood what was going on. So it was a kind of, it was an Ionesco kind of theatre play, really, in Idno.
Yeah. But you came later and you researched the book.
Yes, of course, yes, I came back and, stayed in Reykjavik, stayed in the West End, and was given very generous hospitality by Hilda Helga, and just started to use my ears and eyes and talk to people.
You write about the cliques, the cronyism, the clans as being one of the major reasons for the meltdown.
Yes, I think my task was not to write a history of Iceland. Mm. Yes, other people have done this very well, or reasonably well in the past. My task was to understand how the global crisis happened. It's rather like taking a clock apart. And Iceland was so small, And the Germans say übersichtlich. You can see how every part of the machine fits together.
Uh-huh.
Starting from the grammar school and the commercial school and who kissed whom when he was 13 or 14 and everything. And you just start, because one of the first thoughts about the global crisis was that it had something to do with the growing together of the political and the financial classes.
Yeah.
They came together, they mm-hmm. intermingled. Yeah. And where could you better see that than in Iceland?
Mm.
But of course it was universal. In America it happened that way, or in Britain it happened that way. And that's what Galbraith calls typical bubble behavior. That's to say, when there's irrational growth, irrational expectations from the economy,
mm-hmm.
politicians and businessmen often feel that they're in the same boat.
But you also talk about what you say is an utter dereliction of duty on part of the political class.
Yes, because, the truth is, Iceland is a great nation, but it's a very poor state. Yeah, that's to say, it has a very weak state. And I think, in many ways, it was betrayed by the Independence Party as a state. If one looks back to the way that these David's people rose, the Milton Friedman supporters club. This ideological perspective that they had on the world. I think you could see that they did, they admired Thatcher.
Mm.
They wanted to modernize in the way that Thatcher had modernized Britain. But one of the basic lessons of Thatcherism was that you centralized power and that you created a strong state. That's one of the criticisms of Thatcher too, but that was one of the basic preconditions of a kind of market revolution. Before you go off and privatize, before you go off and surrender power, denationalize, you have to make sure that you have a strong state. And I think they betrayed the state. I think the state is simply been... Iceland has been uniquely badly managed by people like David.
But we see the sort of the clans move in the time of privatization, but at the same time the regulators and the moderators were doing a very very bad job of the whole thing.
Yes, I mean that's just an offshoot of the whole. I wouldn't say contempt for the state. I mean, we're talking about patriotic people, yeah? We're talking about... I have never had any doubt that people like David or Gerharda were true Icelandic patriots and were really convinced they were doing the right thing for Iceland. I have no doubt about that at all. But the truth is, there came a moment when this blinded them, when the ideology blinded them, and they didn't... and they accepted the primacy of the business class. And at that moment, they reached the conclusion Iceland needed this kind of dynamism, needed to expand its market. Mm-hmm. It needed to enter the modern world. And so it in a way abdicated some of the central responsibilities of government.
Mm.
And at that moment, of course, became pretty clear that the regulators would have no function at all in the evolution of Icelandic society. It was, I don't know what got into their heads.
Yes, but you also take quite a close look at the persons involved in this, in the crisis, especially David Oddsson and Jón Ásgeir. And in a way, you look at the part their rivalry played in the whole venture, and they become sort of a rather symbolic for everything.
Yes, that's true. I mean, I think that, I I'm a bit nervous about saying this because Icelanders already, you know a thousand times more about this than I do. But I mean, I do think that Jón Ásgeir in particular, but also some of the other oligarchs, were in fact modernizers. Yeah, mm-hmm. They did in fact do something good for Iceland.
Mm.
Yeah, they basically capitalized it. Yeah, I mean, or at least. Created the trappings of a modern economy.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And I think Odson was also a modernizer. And I think they were both, I just found it extremely interesting that these two people who set out, of course, Jón Ásgeir set out to make money and lots of money, mm-hmm. yeah? Mm-hmm. But his function, as far as Iceland was concerned, was also to make it a presence in the world. And of course, there's, you know, why were people so proud of people like Jón Ásgeir? Well, mm-hmm. because he was making Iceland something important. He was creating the brand Iceland. And Oddsson, for all his contempt for Jón Ásgeir and his this kind of no-name, yeah, no-name Iceland, and this slight arrogance that David had towards Jón Ásgeir, I think that they were basically reading from the same choir sheet. So you then have to ask, well, why did they hate each other so much? Why is there so much of this this pettiness? Yeah, that goes on. It's like a kindergarten fight sometimes between these two men.
Mm-hmm.
And I can't find one of the weaknesses of this book is I can't really find an explanation for this, except that there is some sense of David Oddsson wanting to control his market revolution and not realizing that actually he'd lost it. He'd lost control of what he'd set in train. And I think Jón Ásgeir just represented that. His own weakness was mirrored in Jón Ásgeir. It's not just that they're rivals, that they dislike each other, that they represent different visions of Iceland, but also that they mirror each other in some way.
You say that Oddsson and Jón Ásgeir actually together steered the country off the cliff.
Yes, yes, it's true. Yes, yes, they did. But I mean, it's not. But I wouldn't. You know, I wouldn't over-personalize this. It's true that they did. Yes, by mismanaging. And misruling Iceland, and the other by succumbing basically to greed. Yeah, no one can accuse David of being greedy, I don't think, but just incompetent, perhaps. And I don't think anyone can, accuse Jón Ásgeir of being unpatriotic or anything like this. Perhaps one could, but mainly he's governed by greed, of course. That's natural. Greed is good.
Yeah,
yeah, the gecko, the old Wall Street thing. But it was a whole... it's not that they were acting in isolation. I mean, the Icelandic population was quite happy to let these things happen. There
was also this sort of cult of personality around David Oddsson, and you say that, well, he has an operatic view of the world.
Yeah. But it's quite clear that I think, from what little I know about his childhood, that he liked to be admired, he liked to be praised, he likes to be the centre of attention.
Mm.
He takes criticism very badly. He's very soft-skinned. He's a very sensitive man. I mean, in the good way as well as the vulnerable way. Unfortunately, I think he seems to have developed the sense of having a historical mission.
Yeah? Yeah.
And I think this is the problem. This is kind of hubris. Yeah, that governors govern, ministers minister. Mm. You have to really keep in perspective what your job is. Yeah. Mm. Otherwise, you lose a sense of what you're responsible for.
Yeah. Yeah?
And of course, this is what happened under David. That the government didn't really have any sense of responsibility to the people. Yeah, mm. I think they lost that in some way. And it was part of David's vanity, and which plays into this whole little tragedy, really, because not only is he resistant to criticism, but he really did feel that Iceland needed him in a special way, I think, in whatever role, yeah. He's back again, of course. I don't think he can survive without a role. I know that he sees himself as a writer, as a free poetic spirit and something. But I think if he was just writing, that he would fall apart, because no one would notice him anymore. Yeah, there would be no. He wouldn't be at the center of the stage. He wouldn't be the great diva. I think there is, but you know, it's not for me to complain about a politician's personality. Look, I mean, I've got Gordon Brown.
We'll come to him.
You know, biting his nails and fretting and.
Yeah. But sort of Jón Ásgeir didn't fit into the grand plan, and then Jón Ásgeir he's a strange phenomenon because he's making all these deals in London, but as you say, he's making them from hotel lobbies.
He seems
to be a sort of. And he sort of embodies the recklessness of the whole venture in that way.
But Egil, he's only strange for Iceland.
Yeah.
In fact, he's completely the norm for a West European businessman or even an American businessman. That's how they operate. Yeah. They set up their laptops in hotel lobbies and they do their deals. And they take risks and they're here, they're there, they're flexible. This is what an entrepreneur, you know, well, I wouldn't call him a pirate exactly, but you know. But this is what this kind of capitalism. This kind of capitalist behaves in this way, and I know that's relatively new for Iceland. Yeah, with your octopus and your men in smoky rooms and so on. But actually, Jón Ásgeir is not unusual in the rest of the world. This is why he was accepted. With some reservations by British businessmen, but on the whole he was accepted by British business as being, you know, he just came onto the British stage just like that and started buying this, and they accepted it. They didn't say who's this.
The Icelandic invasion was very successful for a time.
It doesn't matter. It has the illusion of success, which is enough quite often. Yeah, if you're fast enough, you know, when you're skating on thin ice, you skate fast. Yeah. And it's when Jón Ásgeir started to slow down a bit that things went wrong, because then the ice started to crack.
Yeah. You say that in 2005 the British actually sent an agent to Iceland to see where the money was coming from and why things were so badly regulated.
Yes, I know that Icelanders are very interested in this, but I obviously can't name this person, because it would not be good to do that. But it's someone who knows. But I can tell you, it's someone who knows a lot about Russia. And I think the intention was. I think the concern in British intelligence was that Russia was using different countries, including Iceland, to channel funds.
Yes.
And of course, that all dates. I think the reason I mentioned in the book was. Mm-hmm. I wanted to show that there was an awareness that there was something wrong with the Icelandic banking system, that it wasn't being properly controlled, and that money was, and in that situation, money, all sorts of strange money, can come in.
Yeah.
As you know, there have been rumours for years that Russians have been laundering their money in Iceland. And at some stage, in fact, precisely in 2005, the British took that seriously.
Mm. But according to you, all of the ingredients for the meltdown were there already by the year 2006.
Almost everyone realised it. Yeah.
Mm. Yeah. Mm. Except the Icelandic.
Except the Icelanders. Sorry, I forgot. Except the Icelanders.
Yeah, the politicians, the regulators, the central bank, and everybody in Iceland. Yes.
And a few economists hired by the central bank, of course, outside economists. That's the situation. And of course, what happens is Icelanders say, we were let down, we were betrayed by the world. And there is this kind of slight cult of victimhood, I think, in Iceland, that the problems always come from outside. But it wasn't that way. I mean, it did come from outside. Of course, you know, of course there was a, you know, the carry trade exploiting high interest rates in Iceland. There was there were people who were short, you know, short trading on Iceland. But on the whole, Iceland's problems were created by Iceland. I mean, they were aggravated by stupid decisions in Britain and elsewhere. Mm-hmm. But, you know, it's Iceland who is to blame for the Icelandic crisis. And unfortunately, you were so badly governed that, you know, that the Prime Minister didn't actually stand up and say, well, we've made a mess of this.
Oh.
Now we have to work out how to get out of it. And so until that, I think crucial was the Christmas of 2008. I think that's when the mood changed, didn't it? But for 3 months, you simply accepted Gerharder as being the crisis manager of your country, and I think that's crazy.
Yeah,
it was as if you were all in denial, in a way.
You say that he was fumbling and indecisive.
Yes,
you say that Gerharder was a lapdog of Davíð Oddsson.
Well, yes, I mean perhaps that's a bit unfair on Geir. I mean, I know that Geir has a brain. I think the thing is he's very loyal.
Yeah.
I'm trying to put it politely now.
Yeah, yeah? Yeah.
I think he's very loyal,
yeah.
And I think he was very loyal to Davíð, and I think he was excessively loyal to Davíð. And but of course there came a moment when I think even Geir realized that doesn't work anymore. You can't have the relationship between a government and a central bank defined by a loyalty, by a personal loyalty that was set up at school 30 years earlier. I mean, it's just, it doesn't work like that. A modern state doesn't function like that. It can't function on the relationship between two men, one in abject admiration of the other.
Mm.
That's not the way that central banks and governments are supposed to interact.
You also talk of a meeting between Gerharder and Oddsson where Oddsson is sort of punishing Gerharder by staying silent for 15 minutes.
Yes. Well, I mean, you know that. I mean, you know more than anyone else, I think, about Davíð. I mean, he has this power. You know, he's a control freak, is he not? I mean, this is one of his ways of exercising power is to withdraw love, or to withdraw. To make some kind of emotional withdrawal.
If we go to the British angle of things, we have Iceland invading Britain with first the High Street and then Icesave. You published the whole conversation between Árni Mathiesen and Alistair Darling shortly after during the crash.
Yes.
Why is that?
Well, this is known, I think, in Iceland, this conversation. I don't think there's any great secret about it. But for Britain, I wanted to show the British, I wanted, above all the British readers, I wanted to show how arrogant not only Alistair Darling had become, but the whole structure of British power, really. What had happened in Britain over the previous 2 or 3 years is that power had shifted away from the Foreign Office to the Treasury.
Mm.
The Treasury had become really important in Britain. Because Gordon Brown had been Chancellor of the Exchequer, the head of the Treasury, and then his faithful Scottish friend, Alistair Darling, had become the Chancellor. And that was where power was wielded. Mm. And at that moment, October 2008, they felt on top of the world. They felt, because they were both, you know, Alistair Darling and Gordon Brown were both financial experts.
Mm.
They could see something really bad was happening in the world, but they were really unpopular at home. So they wanted to reinvent themselves as masters of the universe, as people who could really solve the global financial crisis. And if you read all their statements between October and November, it's all that. They really thought the British way was right. And in the middle of all that comes this conversation with Mathiesen, in which Alistair Darling quite plainly doesn't want to waste time. He just wants to sweep this man aside, misidentifies him, at the beginning. And that only comes through in that transcript. You can say that in three sentences, of course, but the transcript made it clear, I think, to British readers that that there was that it's got out of control. And now, of course, it's all going wrong, you know. I mean, no one really believes that Gordon Brown has any particular expertise in financial affairs anymore at all. Mm-hmm. He will lose power, no doubt, in May. And, you know, and but that's the way politics works. It goes round in little cycles. And unfortunately, Iceland was caught by Britain at that precise moment in the political cycle when Britain felt really strong.
But was it right of the British government to use this terrorist legislation against Iceland?
Well, I don't know. I mean, of course, Icelanders think that. And I do think, and I understand the hurt that Icelanders felt. I mean, you know, NATO partner and everything else. But I think it was done unthinkingly. I think it was done as a pragmatic measure, as the quickest possible way to freeze funds. I mean, this is why I like discussing the noughties, you know, these years from 2001, because anti-terror legislation has become part of the toolbox of every politician now. And I think that's what had happened. They just opened up the toolbox and said, OK, we can freeze accounts like this, yeah? Without any, you know, without consulting Parliament, without, you know, we can just do it fast, because that's what anti-terrorism legislation is all about. So I think, you know, it was wrong, yeah? And if the Foreign Office had been more powerful at the time, it would have stopped that happening. Mm. But I do understand why it happened. Yeah. And it wasn't... I know the Icelanders think it was a hostile act, mm-hmm. But it wasn't intended in that way. It was intended to save British money. Yes. That's the way it was looked at in Britain.
Yeah.
And they couldn't. And the British, when you tell the British this, they didn't get it. They didn't. They thought, well, you know, those Icelanders are stealing our money. You know, that's what they would say. So of course we have to defend ourselves. It was regarded as a defensive action in Britain, not as an offensive action against Iceland. But that's explaining it maybe a little bit too much. I think it still was a stupid mistake.
But now it seems we are stuck with ISAFE. The Parliament has been debating ISAFE for half a year, almost continuously.
And
we just don't seem to get rid of it.
Well, I mean,
what should we do?
Okay. Well, it is a problem, and I think my fear is that it will stagger on. For many more months, but I don't know. I mean, what is the situation with the International Monetary Fund at the moment? I mean, how conditional is a deal? You know, I think Iceland has to at least pretend to make a deal with Britain and Holland, and just. You know, sort it out somehow, because otherwise nothing's going to happen.
The IMF is, of course, seen as an enforcer in Iceland.
Yes.
As an enforcer.
It's seen everywhere as an enforcer. Yeah. I mean, there's no country dependent on IMF money that doesn't resent it. Yeah. But I mean, if, you know, but sometimes enforcement is good. I mean, you know, sometimes you have to tell your children, you know, not to play football in the street because they might get knocked down by a car, yes? Okay, that sounds a bit patronising, but the truth is that's what the IMF does. It brings in kind of economic teachers, yeah? And says, you have to do it this way, yeah? Otherwise, we're not going to give you money,
yeah?
And because it's the only way that will work.
And don't you think that Iceland didn't have any other options?
I think there came a point when it didn't have any more options, yeah. Yeah, I think it's got to go now. I mean, my impression is that Iceland's doing all the right things. Uh-huh. It actually, in a way that's quite admirable as compared to the rest of society. I mean, I think Eva Joly was a brilliant move and hasn't been. And should have been something that should have been considered by other societies in the global crisis. That's to say, determining the exact criminal component of what happened during the global crisis years, and I think consulting the nation on their expectations, for example, this is something you can do as a small country, but it hasn't even been considered by other societies. Yeah? Mm-hmm. I think something's going on that's right. Yeah.
Yeah,
you know, I think you can get too misled by ICESave and too locked into some kind of discussion. I think that Iceland is actually maybe poised to be one of the first and one of the most successful to exit this crisis out of the other societies. I think there will be big economies like Germany that thinks it's more or less out of the crisis, but will actually be hit again. And hasn't started any process of self-examination or anything like that. Britain too, but Iceland has. Iceland has. I think this must be an unusual moment in Icelandic history where actually there has been a process of self-examination. I don't think Iceland really does this very often, and I think it has, and I think that's very important.
You've also looked into the history of Iceland's relationship with other countries, for example, the US, and why Icelanders feel betrayed by the lack of help in the crisis, why help was not forthcoming from our neighbours and our old friends.
Yes, it is a strange thing. There came this moment, which, and I understand why David, for example, considers himself a historical figure, because, of course, Iceland opened up in a special way to the global financial world under his premiership. You know, I mean, there's no doubt about that he opened up Iceland. But of course, as soon as you open yourself up, you become vulnerable. You become vulnerable, especially if you're a small, undercapitalized country. And you know, we've got lots of people. You've had your Joe Stiglitz on the show. He was already warning. You know, small states are particularly in a vulnerable position. So opening up makes you vulnerable, and I think that's I think the lesson maybe now is, well, I mean, the question is now, what does Iceland do now? Does it close? Does it build up some kind of fortress? Well, it can't, because it's an island. It has to use the protective structure of an island, but it has to, you know, it has to import, it has to export, it has to function as an island. So it always has to remain part of this global openness. And therefore it has to find ways of learning to live with this vulnerability. And I think this is something new for Iceland. It's not new in the sense that it was always vulnerable with fish and the fishing, you know, all these difficulties that come with living so close to the sea and from the sea. But this has become a much more sophisticated sea now. It's much more complex. And the problem, I think, one of the problems was that the economy opened up, it became more vulnerable, but also the expertise was very low. And so the expertise was concentrated in the hands of a very small number of people who said, we're the only ones who can handle Iceland's future in the global world. We're the only ones who know, who understand how to deal with this. And I think that was the moment, that was the beginning of Iceland's downfall, really. That this concentration within a kind of small global class, not just the businessmen and the oligarchs, you know, but these, you know, the people in the banks, you know, it was a kind of, I don't know, you know, people say 30 people caused the crisis. That's nonsense, I think, to be honest. I think it was maybe 150 people.
What about the EU? Do we need the EU?
Yes, I think you do. I'm British. Yeah, I'm not a great admirer of the EU, but you have to see that. You have to compare your situation with Ireland. I mean, Ireland, you know, made all the same mistakes or a lot of the similar mistakes. It's slightly bigger. It has the British market right next door, but it made basically it went down a similar path with this bubble behaviour, and it all went pretty much wrong. But it's not in the same situation as Iceland, and the reason is it's got the euro. It's part of a stronger economic zone. It's got a reserve currency. It can ride out this crisis. And I think that Iceland, you know, it pains me to say this, but I think Iceland probably has to join the euro or join the European Union. But how this is done, I'm not quite sure. How is this done without losing Icelandic identity? I mean, this is not a unique question. Yeah, mm-hmm. I mean, this is the question we ask and been asking for in Britain for the last 25 years, and I'm not sure. I'm not sure. I mean, it's to do with fish as well. You know, the European fisheries policies and so on. Who controls what? I don't know. It's a complicated question because, you know, at the very moment when Iceland should be recovering its sense of sovereignty, mm-hmm. now it has to surrender it, you know.
Yes.
You know, I mean, we should be, in a way, accumulating power in the centre and building a stronger Icelandic state, because that was the weakness. That was whole, you know, the whole of the Oddsson disservice to Iceland was this allowing the state to become corrupt and not function properly. Yeah? He let Iceland down. Now we have a situation where, in a way, Iceland should be building up its sovereign strength and actually showing, you know, making intelligent policies that match people's expectations. And at that very moment, you're surrendering power to Brussels. Yeah. Yes. So it's a very complex thing. But I can see no other solution. And I think, to be honest, that's the way in most of the most even in the Independence Party. I think it must be clear that the euro, or even in the central bank, that the euro is necessary for such a small economy.
But if you owe a lot of money, you don't have much sovereignty. It's beholden to your debtors. And
but I must say that, you know, a great debt sometimes translates into great power. Yeah. This is. It's a kind of negative power. I mean, Turkey, for example, was immensely indebted in the 70s and 80s. Yeah. And everyone had to do what Turkey wanted, because otherwise they weren't going to get their money back. Yeah? Debt can translate into power if it's cleverly governed.
Yeah. Just to finish off, you also look at capitalism sort of in an Icelandic context, the failure of capitalism in Iceland. Well, what lessons do we draw from that?
The premise of me coming to Iceland earlier this year was look at, basically to live in Reykjavik and see capitalism collapse, yes, through my window, sort of thing. But of course, it didn't happen like that. And it was naive to think that this crisis is in some way visible. Yeah? I mean, of course, debt does become visible after a while, and of course, unemployment becomes visible after a while, and of course, shops get boarded up. Yeah. Shops go bankrupt. But on the whole, it's not something that can be visibly measured. So I started to think about, well, what is this then? What kind of capitalism does Iceland have? And how survivable is it within this crisis? And on the whole, it was interesting because, I began to understand that the family structure of Iceland was such that there was, for example, an American magazine writer who came over, and he thought it was a big sensation that a former banker was on the boats, had gone back to the boats. But of course, it wasn't a big sensation at all, because he'd come from a family that had grown up on the boats. He'd gone into banking, was a successful currency trader. The bank went down. He lost his job, or he resigned from his job, I can't remember which. And so he went, he got his captain's certificate, and he's on a boat now. Okay, well, to be honest, that's not, you know, that didn't shock me, because I'm not an American, you know, an American coming from Mars to look at Iceland. But but what was clear is that there's a special kind of skills pool in Iceland that is resistant to the storms of global capitalism. You're not as segmented a society. No. You're never going to have the same unemployment problem as other societies that are hit by this crisis, because you have this structure whereby you always have cousins or you know, or you're related in a certain way. And so even the emigration that you're seeing now from Iceland is linked in to kind of Icelandic mafias, you know, my Icelandic clubs of Icelanders abroad who secure your jobs on, I don't know what, the ferries or between Sweden and Finland, for example, or whatever. And so there's a resilience. There's a resilience that is what I would call a kind of post-capitalistic resilience. Yeah. But of course, I mean, you know, the fundamental problem with Iceland was always it had shifted very fast to modern capitalism without sufficient capital. Yeah. So now the main challenge still remains: how do we get capital back to Iceland so that we can continue to modernize? That seems to me the most fundamental problem. Now, there may be people in Iceland who say we don't want to modernize anymore because it's hurt us. Mm. Yeah, but they're wrong. they're absolutely wrong. We have to find, there are different kinds of capitalism, and there is a specific kind of capitalism, not Nordic capitalism or all these kind of this kind of boring, you know, Danish, Swedish kind of model. Mm. But there has to be some kind of capitalism that links up with Icelandic skills and Icelandic structures of society. And I think you're finding it. I think that's the way it's going. I keep hearing about young kids in Iceland who are setting up software, computer games companies and all these things. It's not that there's a shortage of entrepreneurship. Mm. And I think, As far as I understand it, some of these so-called new banks are actually accepting that and giving them some startup capital. And even if they don't, they can get the capital elsewhere because they're coming up with good ideas. Mm. It's just the shift towards a knowledge economy that will convince people to bring capital back into Iceland.
Not necessarily aluminium.
No. And I must say, you know, I complain about aluminium, of course, as everybody does there. My main problem with aluminium was it was this one big idea. Yeah. I think in the book I wrongly, because I try to pin everything on Odson, or too much on Odson and the Independence Party. But of course, it's a progressive party too thing, is it not? Yeah. Aluminium, and there's something slightly flawed in this governmental psychology in Iceland, which is, let's do this. This will save us from fish. Yeah. So, and if it wasn't aluminium, then it was global financial playing, or it's this, or it's that. But there's always got to be some one big idea. Yeah. And aluminium was so obviously not the right idea. I mean, look at the situation now. You have this almost unlimited supply of clean energy, and you're going to throw it away on some aluminium smelter? Of course not. You have to reinvent yourselves and use this great resource. Yeah, I mean, you can see with all this climate change stuff in Copenhagen, that's you know, you should be the sexiest person at the conference, really. One of the, you know, it's a question of recovering assets. Yeah, recovering Iceland's assets and understanding its strengths and dynamisms. And for a while, Britain thought that, or outsiders thought, that the whole Icelandic bubble, when it collapsed, was the end of cool Iceland. Mm. Yeah, but actually, if you look at the history of it all, Iceland was cool before the bubble. Mm. Yeah, I mean, Björk was pre-bubble. Yeah, and these rock stars were all pre-bubble. Why did they come to Iceland? Why did Eric Clapton come? Okay, to get some fish. Yeah, to get some salmon from the rivers. But also because Iceland had a certain had physical, geological assets, which it had charm, but it also had something special. It had something special that predated all this Christmas shopping in New York stuff. Yeah, and that's the question. So, you know, you can return to that brand. You can return to all those good things and strong qualities that you had before it went wrong. Yeah, I mean, all you've lost is a decade.
Roger, thank you for being on Silver Ales. This is your book, Meltdown Iceland: How the Global Financial Crisis Bankrupted an Entire Country.
Thank you, Edgar.